Time, another Brazilian movie.
Yeah, the first one was Love for Sale, but this one is the first one that we'll talk in English.
Yeah, and it's a movie called I'd Receive the Worst News from Your Beautiful Lips. I find this title so interesting.
Yeah. What would be the worst news? Maybe yeah. It's a question for the end of the episode.
This kind of sums up, because this movie has all this dramatic love story. So when we read this title, we think about someone who is deeply in love. And that's exactly what the movie is about.
Yeah, this passion that will kill you.
This movie is adapted from a book of the same name. In Portuguese, Eu Receberia as Piores Notícias dos Seus Lindos Lábios. It's a book written by Marcel Aquino. And he also works here as the screenwriter for this movie, adaptation. And it's a movie directed by Beto Brandt and Renato Ciasca. And it's starred by the beautiful Camila Pitanga and by Gustavo Machado, Zé Carlos Machado as well. And yes, it's a movie that's placed in the north of Brazil. Have you ever been to the north, Lohane?
I've never been there. Because we have to take a shot together, like for the disease, the Amazonian disease, but I never been there. I never took the shot, so I never been there. Not yet. Maybe one day. I don't know.
Yeah, neither have I, but I do intend one day, maybe. So this movie is about, we have this main character played by Camila Pitanga, Lavinia, this very, very much complex woman who has this dark past that we will know better as the story goes and the story is more explained as the movie goes. So yeah, the first scene we have this, we have to talk about the first scene that we have that woman. Like,
yes, I think she is an Indian.
Yeah,
she looks like one.
Yeah. So we have this guy watching her, and he arrives at this harbor. Can we say call it harbor?
Yeah, it's a harbor. Well, we have this movie. We have love triangle, and we have this beautiful, this amazing woman who is in love with these two nice guys because both are really cool guys.
Yeah. Yes.
But. In the background, we see all the Brazilian Amazonia being destroyed. And we see this from the first, not the first, from the first scene, but the second one, because he is looking at this harbor. And we see the wood passing by in a big boat. So, yeah. Since the beginning, we already know that all this place is being destroyed.
Yeah. We have this problematic situation in the background of the movie. And so we are introduced to Calbi, who is this guy played by Gustavo Machado. And we get to know that he's like a photographer, but not only as a photographer, he's like an artist, right? I mean, he seems to do other kinds of art.
It seems like he is a real fine photographer in the south of Brazil, in Rio, São Paulo. And he went there to do another essay, another photographic essay. Seems like he is that cool guy, the guy who is an artist, who make photos, artistic photos. And it seems like he is there to take photos. Landscape photos. He is there to photograph the Brazilian, what would be the beauty of the Brazilian, but it's not the Brazilian beauty in the sense of landscapes, but women.
Yeah, the Brazilian women's beauty.
So he went there to take these photos for his new essay. So it's not only the beauty, the plastic beauty, but the beauty in this is like when we look to his grandma's photo, when we see all these wrinkles of his grandma.
And then he has this model who is Lavinia. We don't know exactly how they met each other. She's just there to take photos, but we don't know how they got introduced to each other. So, but what we see that is that they have actually a relationship going on. They have an affair. Then they have these conversations, and then he's taking photos of her. But then suddenly all this sexual tension bursts up, and then they start to have sexual intercourse in a very raw way that I was like, wow.
Yeah. Yes, totally. Yes. They are completely insane. And I don't know if they took something, because if she was an addict and she was a prostitute, like you were saying, that I don't know how they got to know each other, because one of the first scenes that she went through to his home, she is there, and we see that maybe he invited her to only to take pictures of her, to take her some photos, because she is really beautiful. She has these eyes, this beauty. She is so beautiful. It's not on a classic way. She can be like a vulgar way and attractive in a vulgar way, but also in an angelical way. And she has all those things. And when he tries to approach her, she looks at him and says that, and she says like, okay, you know that I have a husband. And okay, so he knows her husband, but how they get there? And I don't know, maybe because we know that she has this past where she likes photos, she wanted to be a photographer like him, so maybe this is attractive to her. But yeah, we don't really know why is she looking for him, like, because she keeps going for his home. It's not like she's always passing by, because I don't know if you remember, but one scene that he follows her husband to know where she lives.
Yeah, and during this first scene that we see them together after they have sex, he asks her about her husband, and then she kind of gets mad at this question. That she says, what, like, I mean, he's a nice guy, because he wanted to know if he treated her well, and she says that he's okay, he's a good man. So yeah, we see that he doesn't know very much of her life.
And maybe he was expecting that she doesn't have a good relationship with her husband, maybe this is the why she is searching for him and getting to know him and searching love with him. But it's not this, because for me, first, all those carnal things, all that sexual tension was me, oh girl, this is so self-sabotage. Like, you must have a real good relationship with your husband. You don't feel that you're worth, so you are going to this man who is a foreigner, who is only passing by, and he will destroy you. Maybe he will destroy your life with your husband. And maybe is this the why you are searching for this guy? Because we know, once we know about her past and that her husband saved her, if we say like this, he took her from the streets because she was a prostitute in Rio de Janeiro. So, yeah, we know that he is a real nice guy, her husband.
Yeah, we get to know her husband. He's a preacher, a very well-known and respected preacher in this region of the city. So during the scene that shows him and he is preaching there in the church for the local people, and then we see her there, and after that we find out that he is actually her husband. I was like surprised. I mean, I didn't expect her to be a wife of a preacher, because the only thing that she says to Calbi is that he's a good person, but she doesn't talk very much about him. So
yeah,
she's in this difficult situation where she's married to a very well-known and respected person in this small city, but she's having an affair with a foreigner. And we also have this another character, which is a very important character and interesting character. We're talking about Victor Lawrence, played by the great Jairo Camilo, because there is a night where Lavinia stays over Cowboy's house, and then they, I don't remember if they smoked something or if they took some kind of drug or they were just drunk, but they just,
I think they were smoking marijuana.
Yeah, I think that's
but
it.
But she drinks a lot with him because she doesn't want to be sad, so she drinks a lot. I think since she can drink, it's not possible to drink at home.
So this guy Victor knocks on Cobby's door and he sees her, and she's like in a trance, and then he's like, wow, he says, you didn't see anything, okay? So like it has to be a secret. But yeah, we introduced to this new character who seems to buy some of Cobby's photos, and they seem to be friends. They seem to be friends. So
yeah, because they don't fit there. They are kind of the two foreigners, because
yeah, outsiders.
Victor's life is not the usual life. He is an intellectual. We see that people are simple. Are simple people, common people, ordinary ones. And he reads Veda, he recites poetry. And
yeah.
It's so beautiful, the poem that he made about her.
Yeah.
Oh my god, it's incredible. It's so, 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 so beautiful. And like Cobby says, how can you do this? Because you don't like women. And after that,
you don't even like the fruit, he says.
Yeah. Yeah, it's really funny, but because once we know the story, what it's about, and when we hear this poem, we see, wow, this is real about her, because he puts like the way that men objectify her, and he is talking about her, women, woman is Lavinia, but also women in general. And after talking about the ground, like Amazonia, the forest and everything, like,
yeah,
this is so powerful. This is so, 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 so powerful. And how people are destroying it and objectifying it. And after what will be after all this? Nothing. Nothing will last. It's really, really, really beautiful, this poem.
Yeah. So we know now that it has to be a secret because she's married to the local preacher, who is actually an outsider as well. And then we get to know Lavinia's past. Yeah, we get to know how her husband met her. And I found that scene incredible because he finds her laying on the ground. That reminded me a little of a nymphomaniac scene where the main male character finds Charlotte Ginsburg's character laying on the ground in the same situation. Yeah, so he finds Lavinia laying on the ground in the streets, and he tries to, he reach out for her to try to help her. She seems to refuse because she's definitely on drugs and she is mad. And that scene was so raw. I mean, Camila Pitanga is a great actress. I've always found her a great actress. But in this movie, I think that it's her best work. It's the best work of hers that I've ever seen. She is magnificent, mainly in these difficult scenes that show Lavinia's past. So he's a preacher. He finds her in the streets, and then he tries to give her some comfort. And it's not shown exactly how he managed to keep in contact with her. But somehow she seems to know where he lives, and then she goes to his place. She thinks that he called her to have like sexual intercourse or something like that.
Yeah.
But then he says to her that he's been there. He's been to the same place as her. He shows her that he has these marks on his arms, that he was also a drug addict just like her. And then he found the light. And what light is this? For him, this light is the Bible.
Mm.
So, and then he invites her to the church, and then she goes to the church. And then there again, I was super surprised because a preacher calls this woman to the church, to his church, where he preaches. And then after that, they go to have dinner together. And okay, the next scene is they have.
She becomes the dinner.
Yeah. Exactly.
No. She doesn't become the anything, because she takes control of it. Because all the time that the men are getting her to be pleased and everything, she gets on control of everything and she directs all the thing.
Yeah.
She is controlled somehow. Maybe they think that they have her. But if you look at all those scenes and if you analyze it, she is on the control of everything because she has guided them to make the things that she wanted.
Yeah, during these flashback scenes where we get to know Lavinia's past better, and there is this scene, this specific scene that I found very strong. It's the scene where she tells him about her story, how she left home when she was just 14 because she was abused. That scene is really difficult because we can see that this character Lavinia is like a very disturbed person, but she has all the reasons to be like this because she went through very fucked up things because she was raped when she was just
a lot.
Yeah.
Did you notice when he asked, and what your mom said about this? And we don't have the answer.
Yeah, but she runs away from this question. First thing that I thought was that her mother was against her.
She is a really sad person. Once she opens up and tells him the truth, and then they get to know each other, then she goes to the dinner with him, to the restaurant and everything. And before going to the restaurant, she tells her what she really wants to do. She wants to be a photographer. She once had a camera, but she sold it. She sold it to buy drugs. It's like she opens up for him, and we don't really know if he is listening to her. It's able to listen. I want to believe that he is able to listen to her because he really takes care of her. The way he approached her since the beginning, he holds her and he calms her down. And when she panics, she gets really crazy and he is holding her. I don't know. He seems okay. I have all those things when he starts preaching and acting like a crazy person. Because for me, it's like a crazy person when he starts yelling and praying, but he is really nice with her.
Yeah, I think he meant no harm to her. He really liked her. He really wanted to help her, and because just like he said, he's been through it. He's been there, so he knows how painfully that can be. So I think that he just found something in her that reminded of him in the past when he was a drug addict as well. So yeah, it seems genuine. It seems genuine. It doesn't seem like a man trying to take advantage on a woman.
So their relationship were going deeper and deeper, and they were more attached to one another. And Victor, the reporter, said to him that he was in love with her. And, well, he denied it. He said that it was only a carnal thing, a sexual attraction, because he needed. So yeah, he denies that they are really having something, that they are getting attached. So we have this night when he says to her that he is leaving. And why did he do this to her? Because at the same time that he said this phrase, she remembered her past, the way that she was abandoned, because the phrase that he says, oh, let me take a last picture of you, a goodbye picture. Oh my God, poor thing. She starts, she holds this picture of her that he made, and she starts crying a lot because she's feeling abandoned. And with this phrase, why did he do this to her? Oh, Lavinia, ask me to stay. I think he doesn't know her past, so is this the way she...
Yeah, that's another thing that is not very much explained. I mean, we don't know how they met each other, and we don't know how much they know each other.
Yeah, I don't think he knows it, because he is pushing her to do something that she is not able to do. So, yeah, this is sad. And she breaks down and she runs away. And after the other day, and she says this day that she is pregnant. Is this day or the other day? I think it's this day.
The day that he is about to leave. This is the sequence. He tells her that he's leaving. Then she freaks out. He hits her and she leaves home. And then the other day she goes back and she's sad and he takes a picture of her. She's with a photo of her in her chest. And that's the day that she tells him that she's pregnant. And that's the day that her husband arrives.
Yeah, he holds her. He grabs her in her arms. Her husband grabs her in his arms. And he takes her home. And the other day we know that he got killed. And everybody is thinking that Calbi was the one who killed him, or maybe she was the one who killed her husband.
Because no one knows where she is. Because he was found out killed, but he was found out dead, but nobody knew where she was.
Yeah. And after Calbi doesn't live, he is arrested because people think that he is the one who killed. He is involved in all this crime.
Yeah, his lawyer manages to leave him, to get him out of prison. And then when he's going to his house, I'm laughing, but it's sad, because when he's going to his house and there is this the funeral march for the preacher, people are so mad at him because they think that he was the killer, and he loses an eye, and then he was beaten up, he loses an eye, and he goes to his house, and what he found out, everything was burnt to the ground. He had lost everything. He had lost his eye, he had lost his house, he had lost the woman he loves.
But after he finds her, but she is completely out. She had broken down, and she doesn't call herself Lavinia anymore. She calls herself Lucia. It's really sad, but he doesn't give up on her. In fact, they grown up another kind of love, more affectionate, more pure. It's not a carnal one. It's interesting the way that they show love through this film, because it's a transcendental way. It's more than, in the first level would be a carnal one, but is going deeper and deeper and deeper. Like when she asks, "Oh, what did it happen to you with your eye?" And he says that, I was in love with this woman and I lost my eye. And she asks, "And what did she lose?" And for me, his answer is incredible. Like
he said that she got worse than him. Was worse.
Yeah, what happened to her is worse. And she said, "And did you find her?" "Yeah, I find her. I found her, but I can't contact her yet." And yet is the thing. Like, he has this hope. By the end, it's worth it. Because, she is not completely back in the end, but we see her smile. Like, we see Lavinia's smile. She answered him when he called Lavinia, and we see her smile. She is almost back.
And there's other thing. We don't know exactly what happened to her, what made her so psychologically ill to this level. So because when she is reported missing, when her husband is killed and etc., we don't know exactly what happened. It's not explained. We don't know if somebody did something bad to her. Just see her in this place, what seems to be a mental health place. So we don't know exactly what happened. So we don't know properly what she's going through. But it seems like as long as they are keeping in touch with each other, this is making her feel better. And just like you said, there is no this carnal thing anymore. It's really about unconditional love. He's taking care of her.
Taking care of each other, taking care, like, hold my camera, we'll grab some ice cream for us, holding hands and being with each other. When I was searching about this movie, it's a thing that Beto Branchi says, that this film, the book, were his life. He was reading and rereading this story, Lavinia's story, for about 9 years because he is friends with the authors, the screen Masa player. Aquino. Yeah, Masa Aquino. So they are friends, like more than 20 years friends. And he was saying that he was, since the beginning, he knew that he would make a movie of it, out of it. It's not like transcripting all the things that they are pressing in this movie to in this book to the film. He says that it's a sense of like we are on a road, and this road will get to the movie. It's not the sense that it will be a black and white like the book, because he says that making movies is like always being in a movement. And always changing is the sense of getting to other things, getting to other places. Is this the one made him want to do this movie? And it's really like little flame that it was burning on him, that were moving him to do this film. And he said that when he read it and he knew that this woman would be so complex, so mysterious, so deep, and he knew that yeah, the person who is perfect to do this will be Camila Pitanga.
But what I like about this story is that it starts in a heavy way, although it has these beautiful landscapes and etc. around us, and we see these beautiful imageries of the north of Brazil and etc. But it has a really heavy story. It feels like all the time something bad is about to happen, and then we get to know Lavinia's past, and we know how sad and fucked up her life was, which was really heavy to watch too. But then the movie, after all these climax of tension, it starts to get light. In the final scenes, the final moments, we have this relief sensation that okay, after all the storm,
everything is destroyed, but there is still hope.
Yeah, he loses his best friend, he loses his eye, he loses his house, but in the end, they have each other.
Yeah. Yeah, it's like everything is falling apart. This small city, I really like that moment when they went to the party and she is holding her husband, and the song that woman is singing is really beautiful, the song.
Yeah, people are dancing, yeah.
Yeah, and I don't know, it's like everything is falling apart, everything is being destroyed, but there is still hope. They made like 5 months of preparation to do this movie, and the directors, they went there to Santarém in Pará, and they were living there. They passed like about 5-6 months living there to know this place, to get to know the culture, because they really went there, they really get to know what were passing in the city with these people, because they are not they are people from the city. Most of the people who are getting screened, they are from there. It's not, they are not actors.
We can see this, it feels natural. All the scenes that are shot in location, in open and public places, we can see that they're not extras, they're not actors, they're not people contracted to do the movie. I mean, they're really local people. I think the highlight of this movie, everything about it is like well constructed, their relationship and etc. But for me, the highlight of the movie goes to Camila Pitanga. She was incredible as this main character, such a complex character. And I don't know, I think that she really fits this role. It's like a role that was written for her, because she's this very beautiful woman. Camila Pitanga is very beautiful, and she has this very pure, she has this purity in her eyes. And I think we can see both sides of Lavinia.
Yeah. And yeah, for me, she is so brave. She is so brave, because she passed through a lot. She lose everything, and she's still open to people and hoping that she'll get to a better place. She has a bunch of breaking downs, and she's still holding up, and it's great.
Yeah, and the final scene is beautiful. Like, we can see that after all, she was, even though she was like mentally ill, but she recovered, because the final scene, just him calling her name, and then she looks at him like smiling, because now she knows that she's Lavinia. Yeah. She found herself again.
Yeah,
that's it. Another movie that we talked about. It was good for me. That was a Brazilian movie. I think we should talk more frequently about Brazilian movies.
Yeah. When I was reading about this, and I discovered that they shoot this movie in 8 weeks, I was like, wow, they had a good budget. Because they had Camila Pitanga, and after they had eight weeks to do it. Because I told you that they waited for her 2 weeks so she get she lose weight, and after they screened, and after she had a 1 week pause, so they had money to stop and okay, calm down and everything. But it was really good to talk about a Brazilian movie. But the thing is, it's sad because for us, even though we are Brazilians, but for us it's really difficult to have access to good Brazilian movies. Yes, so this is it.
So bye-bye, everybody.
Thanks for listening to us, and see you soon. Bye.
Yeah, bye-bye.